And we're back. Week two of the awesome Dave Kirschen interview series. If you didn't watch last week's interview, last week we talked about Dave cutting some weight, how he cut, and performance at a meet leading up to a big one, and some issues that he may or may not have had. So this week we're just going to continue on with what Dave was talking about. I'm going to turn it over to him. And because we're having issues with the camera, for some reason, fucking Canon cameras only record for 12 minutes before they shut off. So we're going to keep this one to 10 minutes. So you can watch the whole thing while you're at home. If you're working, you can sneaky watch it at work. So
everything has to be short when it comes to me.
Well, everything is short when it comes to you. Midget digits and, you know what they say, small gloves, small hands. So, you know, you got really strong in that last training cycle. Everything was going well. Leverage were off and you bombed.
Yeah.
Through the squat. And so where did we go from there?
Well, that was kind of an interesting thing because, you know, usually after a bad meet, whether it's a bomb or just a bad performance, it's kind of the same pattern we go through. We beat the shit out of ourselves for, you know, a day and kind of pout and do that whole thing. And then you sort of, you know, regroup. And
you know what's funny is I've only bombed once.
Mm-hmm.
And it was my last meet. It was bench only. Bench only, right?
But yeah.
It's, I think had I bombed, you know, 10 years ago or 12 years ago, it would be different. But this time, we kind of talked about this the other day. I can't, but I didn't throw my stuff around. I didn't get mad. I was like, just fuck it. I made mistakes and it was all my fault.
So that's kind of where I was. It was, I bombed a handful of times before over the course of my career. And what was interesting about that time was, it's not that I didn't care, but it didn't bother me.
Right.
Like, it didn't really feel any emotional cost from the bomb.
You didn't need to throw a tantrum.
No. And what I think, and I realized a couple things. The first thing I realized was I still loved powerlifting, but I didn't really need to compete in it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we talked about that too.
The other thing that I realized was I kind of got to the bottom of why I was doing all this shit in the first place, right? It was never really about the accomplishment, it was about the work.
Right.
And I think a lot of us that get into this really because we seek the work and we seek the process, and the goal is just sort of the carrot that we hang there to get there, to put ourselves through it in a weird way.
Yeah, that's an interesting way to put it.
And I think what I realized after that meet was because I had dove into that prep kind of deeper than I ever had before, and I just basically tortured myself more than I ever had, trying to train that hard.
And diet.
And the shit we were doing, man. I mean, I trained at Hellbent Barbell in Stratford, Connecticut. You know, I'm training with Mike Skeever and Chris Delafop. Chris Delafop just placed second at the most recent, second to Dave Huff. And
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he placed second overall.
Good for him.
Pulled 8-7, like it was 3:15.
Second place is first loser, but if you play second to Dave Huff, that's pretty fucking good, dude.
I mean, he hit a top five all the time until he.
Yeah, that's great.
His whole thing is using extreme amount of accommodating resistance. And I'm talking like 600-700 pounds of chain and band before you get weight on the line.
Everyday circumax.
Yeah, and I'm a scrawny old man.
Yeah.
who's not eating.
Right.
So that was, I mean, there were some days where I just put that last squat bar and I would just sort of fucking wander around the gym just confused.
So if you got 600 pounds of accommodating resistance, what did you use for weight? 25 pounds?
400, 500. Yeah. Because it also deloads to near, near nothing.
Yeah, I know.
So
I know.
You're handling 600 out of the hole.
Right.
And then it's adding 100 pounds every couple inches you go.
That's fucking crazy.
And it was brutal. And doing it on no calories was the hardest thing I've ever done in terms of the sport. And I think in the back of my head,
I think the hardest thing you've ever done was drinking 37 ciders with me in 2 hours.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they didn't have any beer. But anyway.
But I remember the meat.
I was hungover for 3 days after that.
Yeah, I remember the meats. That's a little different.
You remember the meats, yeah, that's true.
And I think, all right, so you remember that old Looney Tunes cartoon? It was Bugs and Daffy, and they're at some like show or some talent contest or whatever. And they're both one-upping each other, right? They're both playing. Mm-hmm. They're each playing their pianos, and then they're. But each act they do ups the ante. So finally, Daffy goes, "All right, you know, drinks the kerosene and the TNT and all the explosive shit." You remember this one?
Yeah.
So he blows himself up, right? Just goes out and says, "This is a children's cartoon, by the way. This is how we
grew up."
So he basically goes out and commits suicide in front of a crowd of people by blowing himself up. And the crowd goes, and the crowd goes, and the crowd goes, and the crowd goes wild, right? The crowd goes wild. And now he does the old cartoon move where he didn't just die, he just became an angel, just sort of floated up in the harp and everything. And so Bugs like, Daffy, that was amazing. They want more. Do it. He's like, can only do it once. And that's what that prep was.
Yep.
I knew in the back of my head I'd only really be able to do that shit to myself once. And that was it.
And that was it.
And I did it.
Yep.
And it bombed.
Yep.
And there was really nothing to show for it.
Okay. Well, something.
Yeah.
There was something
to show for it. In terms of the numbers.
Yep.
So, I'm like, all right. So, I kind of didn't really know where to go.
You bombed because the weight was too heavy. You bombed because you fucked up.
I bombed because I made mistakes, right? But the training worked.
Yep.
I knew the training worked. And I knew I had kind of become what I set out to become. I just didn't get the number next to me. So it took a couple weeks, and I kind of really didn't know what I wanted to do. I was like, I knew at that point that I was ready to, I knew at that point I was ready. I was ready to be done. But I didn't want to go out just, you know,
yep.
I didn't want to go out not knowing it was my last meet, right? So I was like, all right, I'll do one or two maybe this year, and then I'll hang it up. And it was a local meet I was thinking of doing. You know, it was maybe thinking of requalifying for the WPO. I wasn't sure. A couple weeks later, I get the invite from the WPO. Hey, why don't you do the semis, see if we can, you know, get you to finals.
You said semi.
Yeah.
He said semi.
So I decided I was just gonna, you know, try and, I was already shot.
Yeah.
I was mentally shot, I was physically shot. I was like, all right, let me see if I can just keep this going, kind of stretch this peak as long as I can, just to live through this semifinals, and see if I can, you know, get to the big shot on time. And so that's what I did. I couldn't really do much at that point. Like, I zero raw benching whatsoever. I mean, it was up to like 135, and then I'm in the slingshot.
Yeah,
sure. Like, I couldn't. I mean, my pecs are so distorted and ripped down. There was nothing there.
Yep.
I'd be hard pressed to bench maybe 275 raw right now. And this was a 665.
The 665 bench.
You know, my back hurt. My hips hurt. It was just, you know, I had no fat padding my bones and everything. But I was like, you know what, I gotta get through one more time, and this was gonna be at the Arnold Expo. So now it's the WPO at the Arnold, which is what I really entered the sport.
To do.
To do, yeah, that was sort of the, when I was coming to the sport, the Arnold, the WPO at the Arnold Expo was the pinnacle of the sport. So I was like, you know what, I feel like shit, I don't really have another good meet in me, but I'm gonna make it just to make that one last WPO at the Arnold. That's the one box I still want to check off as a powerlifter.
Right.
So I didn't really have it in me, but that's what I, you know, kind of set out to do. So at this point, I've decided that you know, I want to do that last Arnold. I've done the Arnold a few times as part of the XPC.
Right.
And those are great meets, but
not on the big stage. It's always at the.
Yeah, it was always offsite. This is going to be in the convention center, which is pretty cool. And again, you know, maybe to some the WPO would just be initials, like. But for me, it meant something.
Yeah. That's
because that was the apex. So, the problem I had now was I had to basically train for a meet in 3 months that I knew I was not at all physically prepared for and wouldn't be in time. So, it really wasn't a classic meet prep. Basically, it just became I did very, very low volume because everything hurt.
Okay.
So more work just meant more pain.
Yeah.
You know, I kind of
normally after a meet prep like that, I mean, you take.
You take some time off to kind of break down and rebuild. I didn't have that. And I was already pretty fucking broken down for the prep. So.
And the weight cut.
Yeah, so pretty much became all heavy gear work. Bench, there was no real periodization anymore. I was basically just working up to a two board every week to just do whatever I could to get my lockout stronger. And kind of work the groove best I could. I didn't really have a problem touching in the shirt, so I knew I'd be okay technically.
What kind of shirt?
Mid-lace. And so it just became about sort of cobbling all this sort of random training together into some sort of cycle, because I couldn't do any mid-range work. Like, that's, you know, that kind of 70-80% what we do as a secondary, that's out of the question.
Yep.
I just don't have the joints for it anymore. So it basically became doing something really, really fucking heavy for one big strain, and then doing a lot of like really like bodybuilding stuff to try and recover. Still eating super clean. I still had to keep my weight down, so I was still eating the, you know, the chicken, rice, and broccoli and shit. And that was sort of
the. That had to be rough too, because normally when you come off the cut and you come up in the meat, mm-hmm. then you eat, and yeah. then your body uses all that, builds some muscle, fixes nope. everything.
Nope. And not only that,
you can do it.
And not only that, but now I had another 18-pound cut in 3 months. You know, and I've always believed that cuts have sort of a cumulative effect. I never tried to do more than one big one a year.
Yes.
People don't realize how slow it really does take you to recover.
Yes.
Like, it fucks you up for months.
Yep.
So now I was basically wound up being, I followed a 17-pound cut with an 18-pound cut 3 months later. And that's kind of how I was rolling into that meet. And,
and well, how do we do?
Next story. You want to cut this off and go?